Welcome back, everyone. We can start with the next session, which is Raman and Infrared Spectra of Strongly Unharmonic Materials, which is a lecture that will be given by Antonio Siciliano from Rome. Antonio?
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay, yeah, that's good. Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for the opportunity of this lecture. So the topic is Raman and Infrared Spectroscopy of strongly anharmonic materials. So here there is an outline of the talk. So first of all, there will be a general introduction on infrared and infrared absorption and Raman scattering. Then we will see some basic applications. And then we will move on to discuss the missing terms in the light-matter interaction brought in the infrared and the Raman techniques, discussing as well the importance of anharmonicity, of course. And then the last part is dedicated to the time-dependent generalization of the Shah. So now let's start with infrared absorption. So usually in infrared you use a wavelength, you probe your sample with a wavelength which is much larger than the interatomic distance, so you probe Q equals zero excitations, and because of the energy range of the infrared light, you are probing normal modes, and in crystal Q equals zero optical phonons. This is a really important technique because you can probe chemical composition, chemical structure, chemical environments, so you can see which are the components of your system. You can probe also crystal symmetry, and you can investigate phase diagrams. So as changing temperature and pressure, you can see how the normal modes of the system evolve. And what is important is that this is a non-destructive technique, in the sense that is a technique which operates in the linear response regime, in the sense that you do not heat the sample, nor inducing macroscopic or irreversible changes such as phase transition. So usually this is the experimental configuration. You are shining an infrared radiation on your sample. Some of it will be reflected back. So if you measure the ratio of the reflected intensity over the incident intensity in this quasi-normal configuration, you can probe the dielectric constant. But usually in infrared absorption, experiments are done in transmission. So you see that you measure the intensity transmitted through the sample, and this will give you information on the absorption coefficient. So basically you know that from quantum mechanics your system will not absorb any energy, but just an energy corresponding to an excitation of the system. And again, you can show that the absorption coefficient depends on the thickness of your sample, and again on the dielectric constant. So the dielectric constant is the main ingredient in infrared absorption. Is the quantity that contains the excitations of the system, and basically is related to the susceptibility chi. So it connects the applied electric field to the polarization induced. And usually you can think of the dielectric constant as made of two components. So there is an high energy electronic component whose energy range is around the electron volt. So this will give you electronic excitations such as excitons, and band-to-band transition. But today we are focusing on the phononic, on the vibrational contribution, because we are in the low energy regime. So we are we are using infrared radiation, whose energy is of the order of 100, let's say, millielectronvolt. So you can probe, you are probing vibrations of molecules and optical phonons. So this is a sketch of the imaginary part of the dielectric constant. So as I said, at low energy, there are the vibrational fingerprints, the normal modes, so you can probe chemical bonds and environments, and then at higher energy you have excitons and band-to-band transition. So the focus of today is on the low energy part. So first of all, we need a model for the electric constant in an insulator. So I am considering a system with an energy gap much larger than the incoming radiation. So there are no electronic effects, as I said. So you can build a model for the dielectric constant by considering an ensemble of oscillators at the frequency omega mu with a damping coefficient. These oscillators are charged, so they are coupled to the electromagnetic field, so they oscillate with it. So we are thinking about optical phonon. And these phonons, these normal modes, will induce a dipole. So this is the dipole of the mode mu along the Cartesian direction alpha. And this is proportional to the bond effective charge along the direction alpha. And then for each of your atoms and for each of Cartesian direction, there are extra components of the effective charge, which is a tensor. So this dipole is basically the oscillation of your phonon mu, and here there is the polarization vector. So in the numerator there is the oscillator strength. So usually in transmission infrared absorption, you can just probe transverse optical phonons because we are using a transverse field, the electromagnetic field. But if you are going to a non-normal incidence configuration, you can probe also longitudinal optical excitations. And this is an example of lithium fluorine on a metal substrate of silver in a non-normal configuration. So here the idea is that we can excite the longitudinal optical phonon because there is a non-zero projection on the electric field polarization, and the substrate will absorb the field generated by the TO phonons, which cannot be seen in this configuration. So you can see a peak in the reflectivity. An essential ingredient for what is coming are Feynman diagrams. So here there is a pictorial representation, let's say, of the phononic contribution to the electric constant. So the dipole of the mode is represented here. So it is basically an electron hole propagator, which mediates the interaction of your phonons with the external electromagnetic field. And here in the middle there is the dotted line, which is the phonon propagator, which contains, which is basically 1 over omega square of mu minus omega square. So it tells you which is the energy of your optical phonons at gamma. So usually the basic ingredients to compute infrared absorption spectra are harmonic phonons, so second order derivative of the total energy at the minimum of the Born-Oppenheimer energy surface. Then you can add lifetimes using diagrammatic and perturbative approaches, so that you get a finite lifetime for your excitation. And then you need the effective charge, which is basically the change in polarization due to an atomic oscillation. So here is an example of infrared absorption, but in a biological system, which I think is really interesting because you can probe basically all the components of a cell. So basically, from you can see the vibrational fingerprint of the external protective layer, which is made by CH2 and CH3 groups, down to the proteins and to DNA and RNA structure. Infrared absorption is quite used in this field because basically each chemical group has its own vibrational fingerprint, and it doesn't depend much on the environment. So you can see a precise signal of the chemical compound. But there is, of course, another complementary approach, which is the Raman scattering. Usually in Raman scattering you use visible light. Here I'm focusing on the case of insulators, so with an energy gap much larger than the incoming energy of the radiation, so that there are no physical electronic transition, so I'm talking about non-resonant spontaneous Raman excitation. So this is the experimental configuration. You shine a visible light on your sample, and then some of the light will be scattered. And this is the notation for the so-called Porto notation for the configuration. So on the left and right, you have the incoming and outgoing wave vector of the electromagnetic field. And then in the middle, there is the incoming and outgoing polarization of the electric field. So here on the right, there is a sketch of the signal you get in this kind of experiments. So there is a strong elastic peak, strong signal, which is the Rayleigh one. And then there are two extra peaks, which are the Stokes at low energy and the anti-Stokes one at higher energy. So a way to describe the Raman scattering is the following. So the idea is that photons are being scattered by optical Q equals zero phonons that induce a change in the polarization. So in general, the susceptibility chi, which is connecting the incoming field to the polarization, will depend on the atomic motion. So there will be some quantum thermal fluctuation which induce small displacement from the equilibrium Born-Oppenheimer position. So you can basically tailor expand the susceptibility chi by considering the atomic motion, so the derivative of chi with respect to the atomic position. And then, of course, the atomic position will be the atomic motion will be a superposition of normal modes. In this case, I'm considering just the Q equals zero optical phonons, which change the dipole. And so here I'm just considering one mode mu with polarization vector E, oscillating at the frequency omega mu. Then by combining this expression in the square brackets with the expression of the electromagnetic field, you get basically two terms. So the first one basically explains the position of the anti-Stokes peak because you have a dipole oscillating at an higher frequency, and then the same for the Stokes one. Plus, of course, the elastic signal, which is the Rayleigh peak. We have more or less, let's say, explained the position of the peaks. But what I didn't say is that these two peaks usually have a huge difference in intensity, because usually the anti-Stokes peaks are much less intense than the Stokes one. And this can be understood from a statistical mechanic argument, which is quite easy. So in a Rayleigh process, basically you start from a certain vibrational state and you go back to it by absorbing the incoming radiation. While in a Stokes one, basically you can start from the ground state and then you go up in energy. So you this excitation process produce a phonon, a photon at a much lower at a lower frequency, let's say, not much. But in an anti-Stokes process, you get the opposite. So you start from an already excited state and you go down in energy. So basically, if you take the ratio between the Stokes and the anti-Stokes peak, there is an exponential factor which is due to the different population of the energy levels. So this is so basically what we see is that we have an oscillating dipole at a certain frequency, and from electrodynamics you can derive the intensity. So this will be somehow the height of the peak of a phonon with an infinite lifetime. And this will depend on this object here, so the derivative of the susceptibility with respect to the atomic position. So this is called the Raman tensor. So you have two indices which are related to the direction of the incoming and outgoing electromagnetic field, and then you have an extra index which comes from this derivative here. And basically tells you that the atomic position is changing the dipole. So this object here can be computed easily, for example, in quantum espresso, using of course, the adiabatic Born-Oppenheimer approximation, considering only that electrons are responding to the visible radiation because they are much lighter, so they can respond to To the in they can respond in the electron volt range, but then you assume to have an insulator, so actually there are no physical electronic excitation. You just see phonon excitation. So basically, you neglect all the dependency on the incoming radiation and on the generated phonon excitation because it has a much lower energy than the electronic one. So again, I need a description in terms of diagrams. So this is the classical, let's say, this is the expression for the intensity of a Raman peak. So in the numerator, there is this psi, this symbol here, which is the Raman tensor. And this basically contains an electronic response. So you have the incoming photon generating an electron hole bubble, and then through the electron-phonon coupling, you excite the optical phonon in your system, and then eventually the electron hole will recombine to give you the final photon energy. And so again, in the middle, there is the phonon propagator. So usually I would refer to this kind of process where you have a single phonon line as one phonon processes or a single phonon excitations. And so as before, the ingredients are the phonon frequency and lifetimes. Here and in the middle you have the Raman tensor. So again, there is an example in plastics where basically you can probe all the vibrational modes of the groups forming the plastic. So you go from the aromatic vibrations of the backbone through the hydrogen stretching modes, and then you have double bonds between carbon and oxygen, and you can see here are from for increasing wave numbers. So these spectra are, let's say, the standard examples for infrared and Raman absorption, but there are some strange cases, I would say. So the first one is the infrared absorption of silicon. So silicon, by symmetry arguments, is not expected to be infrared active, but nevertheless, you see a strong signal, which is quite broad in frequency. This signal cannot come from electronic or any other types of excitation in the system, and they cannot be one phonon processes. So it's somehow a strange spectra. So now the idea is that this energy range here again matches with one of phonons. So you can try to explain this kind of spectra with a two phonon process. So here I'm just showing you the two phonon density of states, which basically takes into account the summation of energy of phonons in the Brillouin zone with opposite momentum. Because again, with infrared, we are probing Q equals zero excitation. So again, the idea to explain this kind of spectra is that, okay, the energy range is the one of phonons, and the momentum should be conserved. So somehow we are exciting two vibration excitation. So you go outside the gamma point in this sense. And so you can see that the two phonon density of states quite matches quite good with the experiment. But okay, so the idea is more or less correct. So we have to interpret this kind of spectra as a two phonon density of state, but with a modulation. A similar story is for the Raman Raman scattering of diamond, where there is a strong first order line, which is due to the optical gamma phonons, and this is the standard peak expected. But then there is an extra signal at 2200 centimeters to the minus one, which does not match with any of the phonons you expect at Q equals zero for diamond. So this is particularly important because it is the background you need to subtract in diamond anvil cell Raman scattering process. You really have to know what is this thing here. So again, here I'm plotting the two phonon density of states over the experimental data. And you can see that in this case, the agreement quite sucks. But nevertheless, the energy is the good one. And again, there is the idea of Q equals zero. So it's worth trying with the idea of two phonon process. So now let me go back to the theoretical perspective. So what I showed you before are single phonon process. So by this I mean that in the derivative of the electronic energy, there is just one derivative with respect to the mode displacement. So in this sense, I'm exciting just one phonon, one vibrational excitation in the system. And for now, I can basically neglect the vertex with the external electromagnetic field. So these are both one phonon processes with different selection rules. In the middle, there is the phonon propagator, so which basically tells you where you can find your excitations. So now, what I would like to say with this slide is that one derivative corresponds to a single line or a single phononic line. So now the idea is to add an extra derivative to the effective charge and to the Raman tensor. So now you have two indices for the phononic modes. And so you need to have two phonon lines. So this is, let's say, a really theoretical way to build a two phonon process from a single phonon. So phonon process. So in the middle, you will get chi0, which is the two phonon propagator. And next thing I will do is to discuss this. But again, this kind of process here allows you to break the standard selection rules of Q equals zero, and you can explore the whole Brillouin zone. So okay, now there is a simple model sketch for explaining, let's say, what are these two phonon processes. So again, suppose I have this kind of spectra with just two Q equals zero modes, can be both an infrared or Raman spectrum. What is the effect of two phonon excitation is that you can excite both omega 1 and omega 2. So you will see peaks at omega 1 plus omega 2, the summation band, and the difference band, which is omega 2 minus omega 1. In this case, it's trivial because somehow both are Q equals zero, so the sum is again zero. But to go in deep in this two phonon propagation, we need to take into account the temperature dependence. So this, I think, clarify a little bit things. So here on the left, we have the T equals zero case. And this is the expression for the two phonon propagator, where you have the frequency of your phonons and then the Bose-Einstein occupation number. So basically, at t equals zero, the resonant term is zero, and you get only the anti-resonant term. So you can see only peaks at some of the of your phonon frequency. So basically, you can just excite vibration in your system, and then by going up in temperature, the different populations will be activated, so you can see also the resonant contribution, which is due to an absorption and an emission, the simultaneous emission of a phonon. So you get the summation band plus the difference band, and so this basically explains what is this object here, these two phonon propagator. What is interesting of these processes is that basically you can see non-visible modes. So if you have a silent Q equals zero mode that you cannot see in Raman or infrared, maybe you can see its combination with the other Q equals zero mode, because again you completely break the selection rules and you have just momentum and energy. Energy conservation. So this was a simple model for Q equals zero, but you can go also to off-center phonons, as I said. So this is basically a comparison of the two phonon density of states of silicon with the imaginary part of this object here, of the two phonon infrared signal. And you can see basically that there is an effect of the vertex of the derivative of the effective charge, which is somehow changing the intensity and reshaping the signal. And then you can see also the effect of the two phonon propagator, which alone is proportional to the two phonon density of states. But because of the vertex, you're somehow selecting some of the modes. And so then by going from T equals zero to final temperature, you can also see the difference band at low energy. And this matched quite good with the experiments at 300 Kelvin. And because you computed the vertex with the light, you can also tell which are the phonons involved in the process, because of course you can compute them. And in this case, there are combinations of optical and acoustical phonons at the zone boundary. So again, this is not a Q equals zero technique, but you have to conserve the momentum and you can excite two phonons. So the same thing is for diamond, where basically this signal here is an overton of the first order line. So this is somehow the case of the toy model, where there is just a combination of Q equals zero stuff. So in principle, you need derivatives of Raman tensor here and of effective charges. So you need higher order density functional perturbation theory calculation, and this can be quite cumbersome, but you can exploit maybe symmetry by reducing the number of free parameters, and then you can fit the spectra. But of course, in the case of a low symmetry, this is of doubt. Let's see. And then, of course, you have to ask yourself if harmonic approximation is always good enough, or you have to use the SHA or other techniques. So the next example is like the best case scenario for anharmonic theories, because it's this perovskite here, Batio 3, in its cubic phase, which again is expected to be non-Raman active at first order, so for one phonon processes, but nevertheless there is a strong Raman signal whose intensity cannot be interpreted in simple terms of the harmonic two phonon theory. There is basically an opposite trend in intensity, and also it has been shown that you need an harmonic effect to describe this kind of phase diagram. So this is the prototypical case where you need an harmonic phonons that need to be temperature dependent, and where you need to compute the coupling with the external electromagnetic field. And this kind of spectra were interpreted just with a simple toy model of an harmonic double well with the combination of tunneling modes that gives you the spectra. So with let's say, a dynamical disorder model that can explain the average cubic symmetry, which is Raman inactive. So, okay, before moving on, I would like to rephrase both infrared and Raman in terms of response function. So we saw that the one phonon infrared spectra are proportional to this object here, so effective charge with one phonon propagator in frequency, which is basically the Fourier transform of the position correlator. In a moment, I'll try to give you a more physical explanation. Then if you multiply the position times the effective charge, you get the dipole. So somehow the infrared is the dipole-dipole correlation function, and the Raman is the polarizability-polarizability correlation function. So these are useful formulas for MD approach because you have equilibrium averages of these two quantities. So you have an MD trajectory which has equilibrated, and then you can start computing this stuff here. So, but the physical interpretation, I think, is more or less the following. So at a certain time, you induce a perturbation, for example, the dipole, because the dipole represents the interaction with the external field, so you have P scalar external field. So you have a pump field which is small, and then this will trigger some interaction in the material. And then you would like to see how the dipole or the polarizability has changed after you perturb the system. And it, I think, is the physical picture of response function, and of course also of Green function, because they are correlators of position. So as I said, these are, let's say, a sketch for MD trajectory. So you have equilibrated a certain temperature and pressure, and then you can start sample the dipole and the polarizability response. So now we have a practical example before the SHA theory. So this is a molecular dynamics simulation on the high pressure phase of ice. So here the claim is basically that they have observed this phase transition. So the low pressure phase here, for example, 225 gigapascal, is the so-called proton-ordered phase 8. So here I'm plotting the hydrogen position, the proton position, along two neighboring oxygen. And in phase 8, you can see that basically each proton belongs to a fixed, let's say, to a certain oxygen atom. So the molecular structure is preserved. So there are, it is a molecular crystal, let's say. And this is, and this can be seen as an oxygen-hydrogen stretching mode, here at 25 gigapascal. And then by increasing the pressure, basically the double well, the well goes down, and you can start seeing tunneling of protons, and this is the proton disorder at phase 7, where basically the molecular structure of water is lost. And then by increasing even more the pressure, you go to phase 10, which is here at 125 gigapascal, where basically now the potential becomes almost quadratic or quartic, and where there is proton symmetrization. So now the proton sits exactly in the middle of the two oxygen atoms. And the claim here is that this peak here represents the oxygen-oxygen stretching mode that appears with pressure. So this is a classical simulation of, let's say, phase diagrams of high pressure ice with pressure, with full anharmonicity at the classical level. So what about quantum effects? And this is the topic of the next slides. But before doing that, I need a general framework. So I need to discuss a little bit time-dependent phenomena in general. So you start from an equilibrium ensemble of vibrations. So you have the Born-Oppenheimer Hamiltonian of your atoms. And then at a certain point, you turn on an external time-dependent potential, which will be, in general, mediated by electrons. And you want to study how the system responds to this external field, which for now I'm assuming it to be, let's say, a non-small perturbation, so an external potential. Classically, this is easy because you have the classical Liouville equation for a closed system. So you have all the classical distribution, which depends on position, moment, and time, with the Poisson brackets between the time-dependent Hamiltonian and the classical distribution. And the Poisson brackets basically takes the left and right derivatives of position and momentum. So from the classical distribution, you know everything, when you know how to compute observables, and so you know the evolution of the system. I would like to discuss the quantum framework using the Wigner-Liouville formalism. The Wigner-Liouville formalism, basically, you can replace operators, observables, and then time-dependent density matrix, in this case, because this is a time-dependent process, with function of position and momentum. So this is quite nice because you can work with, let's say, classical-like objects, so function of position and momentum, and eventually time, by taking this kind of Fourier transform of the off-diagonal matrix elements of the density operator and of the observables. But in the case of the density operator, what you get is the so-called Wigner quasi-distribution. So in the sense that this object integrated in phase space over R and P equals to 1, but in general, it can be shown that it is not positive definite. So it is not the quantum probability distribution. It is a quasi-distribution. The other nice thing of this approach is basically that you can compute quantum expectation values as classical expectation values, where, of course, you have to be aware of the fact that this object here is not positive definite. So it is not a probability distribution. The evolution of the Wigner quasi-distribution somehow resembles the classical one, because now you have the Liouville propagator, let's say, that has the standard classical part, plus the explicit correction in H-bar. So basically you can study in a perturbative way the effect of quantum trajectories given by this IL of Q, on your Wigner quasi distribution. And this will contain powers of h bar and the higher order powers of the Poisson brackets operator with the time dependent Hamiltonian, which is the classical one, and the Wigner Liouville quasi distribution. So this idea is the one employed in quantum chemistry approach, where basically the idea is to sample with path integral in an exact way the initial condition, so the Wigner-Liouville quasi-distribution at equal zero, and then evolve it in a classical way, and then you can use a molecular dynamics approach to sample the correlation function. So but now comes the SHA part, let's say. So SHA means Gaussian, and Gaussian usually means also harmonic. So now I would like to show you that the classical and the quantum evolution basically coincide if you take the most general quadratic time-dependent Hamiltonian with a time-dependent force constant and a time-dependent average position. So in this case, the quantum propagator is exactly zero because you have to take, let's say, third-order derivatives of this quadratic function, but of course this will be zero because this is quadratic. So what is incredible is that the Gaussian quantum evolution are exactly the same. The only difference will be the initial condition. So you have exactly the same equation of motion, the same differential equation. The only difference is the initial condition. So you choose the initial condition, you choose the character of the evolution. So this is basically the idea behind the formulation we present of TD-SHA, time-dependent self-consistent harmonic approximation. So the idea is, okay, let's take the most general Gaussian for a Wigner distribution. So in this case, I'm talking about the Wigner distribution because you have a Gaussian which is positive definite. So this is a proper quantum distribution. So we take this as, let's say, an ansatz. And in red, I'm reporting the free parameters. So what are the free parameters? The average position, the in time, and the average velocity. And then you have these factors here that takes into account the correlation between position and momentum. And as we will see, these are crucial because they will ensure quantum effect. So how to evolve this classical-like distribution, this Gaussian, let's say, classical distribution? The idea is to evolve with a self-consistent equation where basically you have a self-consistent Liouville evolution where you have just the Poisson brackets of a self-consistent quadratic Hamiltonian where there is the kinetic part and then the averages on this object here of total forces, so first derivatives, which give you somehow the drift of the momentum, and the average of the quadratic part, which controls the evolution of the correlators of position and momentum. So now the only thing you have to do is to put this object in here and to compute the time derivatives of the red parameters. So once you know the red parameters, the free parameters, you know everything because you know that this is a Gaussian, so you can compute with the Wigner-Liouville technique all the observables. What is nice about this formulation is that you can recast everything because you have a Gaussian theory. You can recast everything in equal time correlators. So you get for the first two equations, which are basically Newton-like or Ehrenfest equation of motion, plus three other equations, which are the equations for the position-momentum correlators. So because you are considering a Gaussian approximation, you will have a position-position correlation, momentum-momentum correlation, and position-momentum correlator. So just the quadratic terms of the correlator. Again, the nice thing of this approach is that there is no h-bar. So there is nowhere an h-bar. You can check even here and then here. There is no h-bar. So As for the most general time-dependent harmonic Hamiltonian, the quantum and the classical evolution coincide. They coincide in the sense that once you choose the initial condition, you have a quantum or a classical evolution. So here there is an example of the T-Dichat trajectory in blue, overlapped with the molecular dynamics one on this double well where I'm turning up and down the well. And you can see basically that you can reproduce very well the molecular dynamics. So, but what I would like to stress is that T-Dichat is an exact quantum T, is a quantum theory. Because you can see this, because it is exact for the quantum time-dependent harmonic oscillator that I showed you before. But it is not an harmonic theory in the sense that you are averaging the potential. And as we will see, the averaging the potential will lead you to anharmonic effects. So it is a classical quantum approach, and it is quantum because it is the exact solution in the Wigner framework of the time-dependent quantum harmonic oscillator, which you know, of course, is the classical example of quantum system. So once you turn off the external perturbation, so you put the external time-dependent perturbation to zero, what you get is a stationary solution. Which coincides with the SHA-1. So with the solution, you get at the end of a SHA minimization, but written now in the Wigner framework. And now in the Wigner framework looks almost like a classical probability distribution, because again, it's a Gaussian, with zero correlation between position and momentum, but with non-diagonal correlation between momenta. This ensures you quantum effects because you have the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, and that's why it's important this term here in the dynamics, because keeps you keeps the uncertainty principle satisfied. So for this stationary solution, you have zero average force, zero momentum. Of course, the particles are not moving, and then there is a self-consistent equipartition theorem for the SHA. So at the end of the minimization, you get the SHA phonons, which come from the self-consistent diagonalization of this object here, so average on this object here of the second order derivative of the Born-Oppenheimer potential. And so from these SHA phonons, which are auxiliary quantities as the Cohen-Sham orbitals in DFT, you can, so from this object here, you can construct, let's say, if you want in an artificial way, the one phonon propagator and the two phonon propagator, which for now, they have no physical meaning because they are built on auxiliary quantities. But this is the initial condition for the dynamics. So at t time equals zero, you are at equilibrium with the SHA, and then you turn on a time-dependent potential, and then you need, of course, to evolve with t SHA. So now we need to do linear response because Raman infrared experiments are done in the linear response regime. So what you need is just a small perturbation on the SHA distribution, rho 0, which is rho 1, which will be time dependent, because you are applying an external time dependent field, which is small, again in the sense that it does not trigger any phase transition. And then you want to look at how another observable A will change after you perturb the system. So at equilibrium, these are, let's say, if you want, at t equals zero, these are SHA phonons. But then once you turn on the interaction, once you look at the system, they will become TD SHA phonons. So you perturb the distribution. And so now you have to perturb also the correlator. So there is a perturbation for the position average and for the correlators of position and momentum. And this equation, in a moment I will show you what is this matrix L, controls basically the linearized equation of motion. And this P here will depend on the perturbation, and it is called the perturbation vector. So you have a non-zero perturbation vector, and this is a linear system. But now you have to see what is the average of A on the new the correction, let's say, on the new term in the probability distribution. And this can be written as, again, a response vector, which depends on A, times this vector here, because basically you are doing a Taylor expansion, so you are expanding in R, so there will be a derivative of A over R, over the position, times the correction in the position. And the same for the correlators. So now you can put together these two equations, and you get the TD-SHA response function, where basically you have the response vector on the left, on the right you have the perturbation vector, and in the middle there is this tensor propagator, which I will show you in a moment. So the idea how to read this formula is from right to left. So you perturb the system, this will represent the following interaction of the SHA phonons, and then you close everything by looking at how the observable A has changed. So you can choose the dipole-dipole or the polarizability-polarizability response, and you will get infrared and Raman signal. So now I have to show you the expression, okay, which is this one. So on the right, there is the perturbation vector. So you have equilibrium averages of derivatives of B, of the perturbing potential, on the SHA ensemble. So the perturbation as the response vector can be computed quite easily at the end of the SHA minimization. This will be the topic, I think, of the hands-on, right? Okay, so the response and the perturbation vector are easy quantities. And in the middle, the inverse of this matrix here will tell you how the phonons will propagate. And you recognize that on the diagonal, there is the one phonon SHA propagator and the two pieces of the two phonon propagator. So you have to evolve both single and double excitations, and there will be also some mixing. And this mixing is given by the scattering vertices, which are D3 and D4, which again are equilibrium expectation values of the third and fourth order derivatives of the Born-Oppenheimer potential. So, and this will represent the scattering vertex, so there will be in general an interaction between the SHA phonons, and this will give you the TD-SHA ones. But I think the first thing to do is to look at the non-interacting response, so you set to zero the interaction, by interaction I mean the scattering vertex. And what you get is basically the non-interacting SHA response function, but where, of course, you have always to be aware that these are not harmonic phonons, they are auxiliary quantities, so harmonic phonons dressed by anharmonic effects. What is interesting is to see how to get them, because I think this will also clarify the meaning of propagators and all these many body formalisms. So you can see that you can get G0, so the line, just by setting A and B proportional to the displacement. So this means a displacement of the centroid position. And this way, if you would do the matrix, you get just G0. So the one from propagator is actually, as I said, the perturbation in the position. While the two phonon propagator is a perturbation quadratic in the atomic displacement, so it is a breeding of the Gaussian. And so then you can do, of course, the inversion now is already done, and you can do the matrix vector multiplication, and this is what you get. So you get this following form from the response function. So this is the SHA response function, because all you need to do, all you need are SHA phonons, one phonon and two phonon propagator, where one phonon processes are triggered by first order derivative and two phonon processes by second order derivatives. And there is no interaction. So we have to to add this interaction. And naturally, we have found that there are two phonon processes. So somehow this explains, let's say, ab initio, how the spectra of silicon and Raman can be explained. Okay, so this is the full expression of the TD-SHA response function. So now we have to derive the interacting propagator. So this is I think the hard part. So to get the interacting one phonon propagator, we learned that we need a linear perturbation in the position. So I'm saying interacting because now we have both D3 and D4. So we need a linear perturbation of the position of the Gaussian. So you put this vector here will be 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. And then you need to invert this matrix. And this inversion will give you exactly the dynamical generalization of the SHA phonons given by Raffaello Bianco. So the real imaginary part of the inverse of the Green function will give you the physical phonons and the lifetime. And then for the two phonon interacting propagator, you will need again a quadratic perturbation. So you are perturbing the you are breathing, you are letting the Gaussian breathing. So there is there will be an interaction between the two phonon excitation, and this is given by the partially two screen phonon propagator. So where the two phonon SHA propagator can just propagate only with the fourth order scattering vertex, but then there is an extra decay. So because there is interaction, you will get cross terms between two phonons and one phonons. In this case, the partially screened two phonon will decay in the one phonon interacting channel. And then finally, what you can do with the Gaussian is to mix the perturbation of the breathing and of the position. And what you get is this gamma, which will start with a SHA phonons, but because there will be in general a third order vertex, you can create a dressed two phonon process. So there is basically a hierarchy of diagrams, and in the next slide I will show you that you cannot ask more. So what about three phonon propagation? So in a three phonon propagation, basically an example is the Southern diagram. So you have a single phonon which decays into triple excitations. These triple excitations could be described by a cubic perturbation, but this cubic perturbation in a Gaussian doesn't make sense because, of course, once you have the first and second momenta of the Gaussian, then everything stops because you have Gaussian. So what you get is a disconnected diagram, which is irrelevant for the dynamics. So basically with TD-SHA you have just one phonon propagation, two phonon propagation, and then the mixed term, but that's it. So basically the reason is that in this case here you have three phonons at the same times, but this cannot be done in the TD-SHA framework. So I think that the next step is to show you how you can compute the response function, because it is the topic of the Enson session. So in general, so if you have your custom A and B, so you have something in your mind, what you have to compute is this. So this big matrix inversion, where there is the one phonon channel which scales as 3n times 3n. So here is cut. Now it's here. Okay. So because it is in general an n mod times n mod matrix, and then there will be the two phonon channel which scales, let's say, less the four phonon scattering vertex. So n mods to the power of 4. So in a given supercell of atoms n, the full brutal force inversion will scale as n to the power 6, and this is impossible. Even the storage of the matrix is impossible. So the next thing I will show you is that how this can be done with the Lanczos algorithm. This idea comes from Monacelli and Mauri. where basically you can compute this object here in one shot for all the frequency you want without doing MV trajectories. So the key quantity is basically let's say a simple matrix vector product with the inversion. So, but we don't wanna do the inversion. But I will show you that once the propagator L, so this enormous matrix here, is in the three diagonal form. So you build with the Lanczos algorithm this basis here S and S to the minus one. Once the propagator is in a three diagonal form, you can get the response function really easily. So you need the Lanczos algorithm. The Lanczos algorithm is initialized with P1 and R1, which are proportional to the response and perturbation vector. So this is what you can do. You will do it in the ensemble session. So this is the first step in this is the easy part. But then you have to build the S and S to the minus one matrix. And this is done basically by a recursive application of the propagator on the perturbation and the response vector. So at each step, you are computing the vector P2, P3, blah, 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 up to a certain step N. And you will see also, I think, how many steps you need, more computational detail. With, of course, the condition that pk dot rl is equal to the Kronecker delta. So once you have built this transformation, you can use it in a response function. So s times s to the minus 1 is 1, of course. And so this object here in the square brackets becomes the inverse of the three diagonal matrix plus omega square. And then you need to compute R1 times S, S to the minus 1 times P1. But this is will give you a vector with all with just 1 at the beginning and all zeros, because basically you initialize the Lanczos with P1 and R1. So, this, for example, this will be R1 times P1, 1, but then R2 times P1 is 0, and then for all the vectors. So you just need the first element, first row, first column of the three diagonal plus omega square, and this can be done with a continuous fraction. So the idea is now, okay, we need this first element of the inverse, and so you can use a recursive 2x2 inversion. So what you need to do is to take A omega square plus A1 minus B1 times C1, because this is a three diagonal, these two vectors here have just one entry, which is non-zero, all the other are zero. But then you need let's say this block here to the minus one, and then you need as well the first element, first row, first column. So you need this element to the minus one, so you can use recursively the Lanczos, the 2x2 inversion, the idea of the 2x2 inversion, and so you get a continuous fraction. So once you have R and P, you have done the Lanczos calculation, so you have the coefficient, so you can compute in one shot the response function for all values of omega. So you don't need MV trajectory, and moreover, it is an interesting approach, because if you have a low symmetry system, you cannot use low energy models with few parameters, where you can basically fit the interaction with the external probes. So in this way, you evolve all the phonons, all the Sha phonons in the TV-Sha framework without any empirical parameter, and also with three and four phonon scattering vertex. So the general response function looks like something like this. So you have now we have more or less understand that the real excitations of SHA are the TD SHA propagator. So 1, 2, 1 plus 2, and as before, the coupling with the external field does not change. So now we'll show you some infrared examples. So in the infrared, you need the dipole-dipole correlation function. So the effective charge will be coupled to one phonon process. But in general, you will need to average to take into account quantum thermal fluctuations of the system. So you need to compute the effective charge on a displaced atom configuration supercell. So you need to do some configuration to compute this vertex in this way. But then you need the derivative of the effective charge. But as this vertex is an average on a Gaussian distribution, you can integrate by parts. So basically, there is no need of computing this with the FPT or whatever. But you just need to average force effective charge times forces, as you need in the SHA minimizations. Basically, it's the same trick. And of course, a simplification can be done by considering the effective charge at the equilibrium position. But in this way, you are neglecting the, let's say, the two Fonon process, which come from the fluctuations of from my position dependence of the effective charge. So the examples I will show you will be an infrared spectra on high pressure hydrogen in the molecular phase C2C with 24 atoms in the unit cell. So this is a molecular one of the best candidates for phase 3 of hydrogen. It is a molecular phase where the molecules are well defined. So this is the unstable mode of the C2C phase as you increase pressure, and you can describe this phase transition only with the fourth order scattering vertex. So now here I'm showing you like the best TD SHA calculation you can do with both two Fonon and one Fonon processes, averaging the effective charge. So this is the solid line. And the dotted line is the calculation with just the effective charge at equilibrium configuration. But you can see that we completely miss this overton here, which is due to the interaction of the SHA phonon. So this is a purely two phonon processes that you cannot see by just taking the single phonon channel. So this is the comparison with the harmonic spectrum, where you can see that there is a huge renormalization in the vibrant frequency, which is this one here, which is basically the vibration of the hydrogen molecules. And of course, there's a huge change in the low energy parts, so where you have translation and vibrational modes of the molecules. The same thing is basically for Raman. So you just need to replace the effective charge with the Raman tensor, and you will do it in the Enson. And again, there is no need for higher order electronic response. You can integrate by parts, and you just need Raman tensor. So the example I will show you is the a Raman spectra on ice phase 11. Which is a proton order phase of ice stable below 72 Kelvin, which is the proton order counterpart of normal ice. And the calculations were done in the bubble approximation that you saw before. So by considering just the correction to the self energy coming from the three phonon scattering vertex and the two phonon propagator. And also, it is enough in this case to consider just the Raman tensor at equilibrium position, so without two phonon processes. So you can see that there is a perfect agreement between the anharmonic TD-SHA spectra and the experiment. And you can see also that you can reproduce this overton here seen in experiments. And this is due, you can check it this by looking at the spectral function. So this is a combination of librational modes and bending, so the low energy modes, which you can see that are well separated in the spectral function. So you have translational modes of the molecules, then small librations. By libration, I mean a small rotation of the molecules. Then you have narrow bending and stretching of the molecules. So, okay, but in general, you have to be careful when assigning the peaks because this object here also gives. Okay, that's finished. Okay, I finished. Ah, 10 more minutes. Ah, okay, I thought it was stop. okay, so you have to somehow check that the overtones you see can be assigned either to the real two photon process or to this overton, which comes from the self energy correction in the bubble approximation. Okay, so we can skip this. Okay, so now we have conclusions. So I hope you that I showed you that TD SHA gives you the physical phonons. By physical phonons, I mean the one you can probe you can see in experiments. And I think I showed you that it's really important to consider the scattering vertex also in the simplest harmonic case. There is a modulation due to the interaction of light, electrons, and then with phonons. And that with TD SHA you can do higher order phonon propagation up to the two phonon propagation without any further DFPT calculation. So linear response calculation is what you need. And the last thing is that this is a general framework. So you can build your own response function. And then TD SHA will give you the correction in between the scattering vertex, so we'll correct the SHA phonons into the real one. And this, okay, thank you for the attention. So this was